Well, it looks like you're the one who needs to be taught a lesson, pal. Class is paying 101. Your instructor's Casey Jones.
Look, I don't want to fight you.
Well, tough rocks, pal.
It's a cup of coffee in the big time, yeah. Cup of coffee in the big time.
Hey, what do you say we both be independent together, huh?
We have the tools, we have the talent. It's Miller time.
I said empty your mind. Be formless, shapeless, like water. Now you put water into a cup, it becomes the cup. You put water into a bottle, it becomes the bottle. You put it in a teapot, it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow or it can crash. Be water, my friend.
The world ain't all sunshine and rainbows. It's a very mean and nasty place, and I don't care how tough you are, it will beat you to your knees and keep you there permanently if you let it. You, me, or nobody is gonna hit as hard as life. But it ain't about how hard you hit. It's about how hard you can get hit and keep moving forward. How much you can take and keep moving forward. That's how winning is done. Now, if you know what you're worth, then go out and get what you're worth. But you gotta be willing to take the hits. And not pointing fingers saying you ain't where you want to be because of him or her or anybody. Cowards do that, and that ain't you. You're better than that.
Well, that's great. Either I have a monster in my kitchen or I'm completely crazy.
I don't think you're crazy.
You know something? Maybe I am insane. Maybe I am insane.
You know what you need? You need a Brazilian plastic surgeon.
I've got one that can see.
It's showtime.
All right. Welcome to Comic Book Radio. I'm your host, Peter Cimetti. This is episode 93. Man, I hope you guys are having a good one. It is a Sunday, October 15th. How is it October 15th? Where has this month gone? Where has this year gone? Holy smokes. My guest tonight, Per Berg, also known as Narwhal. More familiarly known as Narwhal, of course. We're talking about writing a supernatural murder mystery. He's got Hotel Story on Indiegogo. And we'll be talking about a bunch of other things too, of course. But yeah, mostly that's the episode tonight. You're in for a good one. Narwhal's in the chat. Look at him right there. Fritzy Schnitzel, hope you're doing well. Thank you for being here. Grape Nuka-Cola in the house as well. What's up, Grape Nuka-Cola? Levi Skeen is here too. What's up, Levi? Steve I.M. says, good day to you. Well, good day, good evening as well. Jed Ojaga in the house. What's up, Bobo Ayami? Hope you're doing good. Manny Cornejo's here. What's up? Levi Skeen says, best intro in the biz. Thank you, man. Appreciate that. I owe it all to every single clip and Bill Conti's spectacular music there. Goody Two Shoes, hope you're doing well. Thank you for being here tonight. Shrek PMC is here. What's up? Dale, hope you're doing well. Says the cream rises to the top. Yeah, macho man. Macho man. I got it's not a cup of coffee, but it's like a third. A third of a large. Third of a large of coffee in the big time. Holy hand grenades. What's up? Hope you're doing well. Spaceman is here tonight. What's up? Coming down from above. Wayne, hope you're doing good, Wayne. Thank you for being here. Mr. Beeps in the house. What's up, Mr. Beeps? Let's see, who else is here? We got Praetor7. Hope you're doing good. Jake Blues, thank you for being here tonight with us. Brian Suddenly Old in the house. And so is Ara. What's up, Ara? Hope you're doing well, man. Thank you for being here. And look at Ara. He's saying hello to everybody. He's so nice. Thank you for being here, Ara. And everybody, thank you for being here. So, but without further ado, let's bring him on, right? The reason we're all here. No,
hey,
what's up?
What's up? Thanks for having me. Jinx, I think we both said what's up at the same time. I don't know if that works with the internet. You know, like, I heard it at the same time as I said it, but I don't know.
Does that mean you have to unjinx me now? Otherwise, I can't talk? This is going to be an awkward show.
Yeah, I forget the rules of the game. Is this the one where if you see this, then they get to punch you? You ever seen that?
Yeah, there's that one. Yeah, there's a couple of them. You know, we come up with ways to harm each other for fun.
There was one on the soccer team. The soccer captain used to do this thing where he would pull the scrotum skin of his nut so tight around his nut and flash you just that, and you didn't know what it was. You're like, what is that? And they would all just laugh, except I tried to do it to him once, and he knew immediately what it was. He goes, pow! And he, like, nailed it with his finger. It really hurt.
We're starting off with a banger tonight. We're talking scrotum skin? Is that what we're doing, Narwhal? All right.
We can edit that out, right? Oh, shit, we're live.
No, we're live. We're live. Look at Narwhal. Narwhal, do I have to remind you again? We try to keep it PG-13 on the show, of course. We want to offend people with what we say, not how we say it. But you're going through scrotum skins and S-bombs within the first minute of the show.
Okay. Oops. Okay. Fair enough.
We are live. All right. There's no good segue for this. No good segue at all. So as far as writing a murder mystery goes, right? Because that's what Hotel Story is, correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So writing a murder mystery, what are some of the key components to your murder mystery?
Yeah. Well, so someone's got to get murdered. And then you can have the question, do you let the audience see it or not? So the true, like, noir, if we think of murder mystery like that, where you follow just the detective, you know, that's kind of like the mystery. The point of view of the audience is identical to the detective. You know what he knows. That's like mystery. But you can do it as suspense, where the audience sees the murder and then you kind of follow the detective and you're like, when's he going to figure it out? He's talking to the killer right now and he doesn't know it. Is he going to figure it out? And like, that's at Columbo actually does that.
I was going to say Columbo style.
Yeah. And that's like
dramatic irony where we know and he doesn't.
Totally. Yeah. And that's a lot of fun too. They use that at the end of Silence of the Lambs and it's really great. And for ours, you do kind of know the bird's eye view, like they're more suspense. You do know the bad guys right away. And there's not even per se a detective as much as it is kind of like a cops and robbers heist plot, almost like it's almost like a little bit more like like Die Hard almost, this one, because it like all takes place in one hotel. There's the murder / murders is kind of happening, and then the one like enforcing angel, we call him the liminal angel, he comes in. So it's like a witch versus an angel, and the angel can only possess dead bodies. So there's like a little game of chess between them almost, where she kills one body because she kind of wants to control it. So that's his only way in. But she has that body pre-tied up. So as soon as he even comes in, he's already screwed. And then she begins a spell to actually just banish him. And he has to get out of that situation kind of thing. It's like, this is all like, Cerberus is a little bit more of a murder mystery than this is even, but this is still, you could kind of classify it as that. But.
Yeah, you're writing murder mysteries all over the place.
Yeah, it's an easy way to start a story and get inspired if you're like, let's kill someone and then try and figure it out.
Yes, within the story, let's kill someone.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, with any good murder mystery or whatever it is, but especially this type where you've got everything taking place in relatively one setting, what is bringing people there? Why are they all there together?
Oh, yeah, that's a good question. Yeah, for ours, it's a event. A tennis tournament is like the following weekend. So it's kind of like a Friday night. There's athletes arriving. There's fans arriving. And then there's even kind of a provocateur, we called him the accelerationist, arriving, and he's kind of almost like a terrorist, but terrorists are obviously terrible people, but you know, people are very sensitive to that right now even. But this guy, part of the plot is like, how bad is he? Was he gonna kill people, or was he like doing something a little bit whatever? Because he's and then part of it too is you're following these characters. And some of like the interactivity, which we've talked about past you and me on your channel, is there's kind of like judgments and relativity judgments from the audience. So they're kind of, this happens in a lot of these kind of movies where you have like eight people that you follow and the audience will kind of rank them. They'll be like, all right, I'm rooting for him. They'll sometimes be like, I actually hate that guy. I want him to die. And you can kind of know that they'll be thinking that, and you can keep having that guy survive. And they're like, damn it, when will that guy die? And one movie specifically that does that is, because a lot of my influence is a little more movies than comics, but I love comics. We can talk about that too. But there's a movie called Train to Busan. Have you ever seen that movie?
No, I've heard of it though.
Yeah, that's a cool one where there's kind of just a random guy who totally sucks. He is a coward and it's a zombie movie, but he keeps surviving and he keeps sacrificing other people so that he can survive. And he just makes it all the way through the movie and you're like, fuck that guy. So they build it up really good for him being like a really bad guy. Kind of. Oh, I swore again.
That was your one. That was it. You got no other F-bombs left, Narwhal.
Okay.
But yeah, Jake Blues enjoys that movie too. Says that movie's awesome. There you go.
Yeah.
Bear as well. So yeah, look at that.
What's up, Bear?
So how are you going about it in terms of setting up motives for characters? Do you find that that's a difficult thing to do, to give everyone kind of a unique motive as to why they want to either kill someone else or take someone else out or steal something, anything like that?
Yeah, once the chaos starts, then their motivation can mostly be like survival. Like even that would be like, again, kind of a zombie movie prototype, but the original Dawn of the Dead I really like, where it's like, what are the alliances? What are the plans? What are their strategies? What can they even do about it? But before that, it's good to have a little something going on. And sometimes with stories structurally, they call that the status quo. Like, so you go into the story and everything's normal, but you're just observing. Even like a Star Trek episode is like this. Like you go into a Star Trek episode, it's the status quo. Usually there'll be a task at hand, but it's like very normal. So they'll be like, we're delivering like food to somebody who needs it, just a standard Star Trek mission. And then something kind of crazy happens and then kind of the story gets going. So we do have some of that going where the kind of initial thing that's even happening is just like, it's actually some of it's from my experience from my real life of working in a hotel, but just a very disgruntled guy who's staying there is making a huge scene. And they're kind of, everyone's dealing with it. It's in the lobby, so that's kind of chaotic, but you meet every character and how they react to that. Like there's people in the bar that can overhear and they're like, what's this guy's deal? And then
that's important. You're establishing character within the mind of the reader, you know?
Yeah. And then pretty quickly things get moving. But
yeah. Cause yeah, then you can play upon that. So you can make it where you can have the reader try to predict how certain characters are going to react in certain situations. And then, you know, before you know it, you misdirect. And now all of a sudden you're like, wait a second. I thought they would have done that. Why did they react like that?
You can get little character arcs going. And sometimes if there's that many characters, there may not be like a huge hero's journey character arc. But one thing you can do is have characters that anime or manga does this all the time and I love it, but their character arc is just their relationship. So it will be people that kind of don't like each other at first starting to become friends. Like that kind of thing is a lot of fun to do in those kind of stories. And the audience, like you're saying, has those initial reads on the situation and you can play with those expectations. Yeah, this is a good interview. You're getting me already saying more than I normally say about this story.
good. I'm doing my job then. My job is to help you spill the beans without you spilling the beans, if that makes any sense.
Yeah.
So let's pivot a bit. When it comes to the art on the book, what's going on with that? How are you putting that together? I know you got an artist on the book as well, but you're helping out as well, right?
Yeah. It's a big centerpiece for my buddy Jared Jewell, who's a jack of all trades. I met him like 12 years ago at Iowa City. I lived there for a little bit and I was going to some clubs on campus to kind of make friends really. But one of the clubs was a video game making club. And within that club, he one day organized a weekend comic jam. So we got food and pizza and stayed in their lab, which had all the cool computers and stuff, we lived there for 48 hours one weekend and we all made a comic. And that was a fun bonding experience and really fun to do. And his comic, even then, I was like, oh, this guy's got something that I've never seen before. And he always has that quality where it's not even like it exceeds my expectations or it's less or it's like what I expect. It's just always, I can't even imagine. He's always on a different level. So I just always get such a kick out of it. So we've been collaborating. Every chance I get, we'll have a little opportunity to have a little collaboration. But because of Comicsgate and kind of I had some success within that to just be able to reach out a little bit to some artists. So like Monica McCagney, I worked with Cerberus. And then Jared Jewell, I reached out. I was like, we should do a big project. And we have a ton of emails because we kind of wrote it almost back and forth via email for like a couple months. And we have all those emails. So we are going to release with the book a huge 64-page at least, kind of collecting the emails, the early art, some of the making of. Because we're kind of another aspect of this is Jared was my colorist on Cerberus, speaking of him being jack of all trades. So we have been working together and then we're using kind of the workflow that works for animation, but I use it on Grand Prix where we do low poly 3D backgrounds and kind of take the camera and actually take pictures of the camera angles and then draw the characters over the top. So one thing that's fun about that for this story though, is it does give the hotel a really because it's the one location for the story, the hotel gets to be kind of iconic in a lot of ways.
So kind of like the way the Overlook Hotel within The Shining is a character unto itself.
Yeah. And like we had like a map of the hotel when we're designing the story and even like the strategies for the good guys and bad guys. And because the basic plot is there's this mass sacrifice spell playing out that the first wave of it kind of turns a lot of people into basically like zombies, which there's like some nuances to that, but people will understand when they read it. But then, so it's a little bit of this scenario of survival against the hordes, the few people who manage to dodge that initial spell and what they're going to do. You know, one of the first things that they do is like try to leave. And then this is like a classic horror trope, but the part of the spell is that the surrounding area surrounding the hotel has become this giant misty ravine and you just can't get out, you know, so.
So almost like it feels like it's existing outside of reality in a way.
Yeah, it is. It's like it gets pulled out of reality. And then that's when the angel, they become aware of that this witch has cast this spell. And they're like, she's going to do, we got to try and stop her. But part of the spell too is it stops them from getting in. But like we can send one person in.
Was it a conscious decision from the start to make it a supernatural kind of vibe? Or did that develop?
Yeah, I have a handful of scripts that are kind of like half written. So they might have been like false starts at various points and I might've liked them, but they're just kind of sitting there. And this is one where I eventually did pull the trigger to take it to Jared. Cause we were thinking about what to write and what to work on for a while. And finally I was like, all right, this one, I know that this is half written but you and me, we're going to go back to the drawing board on this and do the whole thing and power through. Because it can be a little intimidating because the story is kind of so simple. So you have to know, it's like a leap of faith knowing that there's going to be enough there to make this a full, fun graphic novel when all it is like eight people versus a witch in a hotel. So you're like, all right, what happens? So there's a lot of brainstorming, a lot of like trying to fit like kind of a structure that works over that where you do have some like table turning kind of things, some unveiling of like more rules to the supernatural aspect and how that changes the game. Yeah.
Well, you got to reveal, you know, bit by bit. It can't just be all thrown out in the beginning. And because then you can, then you form a very predictable, boring story.
Yeah. I'll give you one example. So this is like, not exactly spoilery, so I don't feel bad, but this is like a cool aspect. So one thing is, the mirrors, once the spell gets activated, the mirrors become like portals, but you can't breathe in the mirror world, but you can use it to get from point A to point B if you hold your breath so that they can escape some scenarios like that. But then the way that that can evolve is the witch inevitably kind of figures out they're doing this. So she orders all the mirrors smashed. So all the mirrors in the whole hotel get smashed, but then you got all these smashed mirrors and they find one shard and manage to save it that's like big enough for a person to fit through. And now they have this portable portal with them. And so there's something they can use that for. And what one of the ways they end up using it, just kind of out of the blues, they basically use it as a shield, because if someone shoots at you, you hold up this portal. The
bullets like goes through it.
Yeah, yeah. So that kind of stuff kind of plays out in a fun way.
Yeah, Alex, we'll do that if Narwhal wants to do that. Do you want to do that later?
Yeah, yeah, let's do it. What's okay. up, Alex? How's it going?
Yeah, we'll do that later. I'm trying to be better with that because I found that some guests, they don't want that to happen. So I'm trying now before we go into that. If there's people in the chat that want to have that experience, we'll do it. And if the guest is comfortable with it, we'll do it as well. But Narwhal, you run a channel. You're always talking to people. So I figured you'd be okay with it.
I've been getting a little bit better at it. I was watching, I rarely rewatch my videos, or I wasn't in the habit at all. But then I've been doing it a little bit since I launched Hotel Story, because I've been streaming a lot. And I was like, I think I'm saying less. So that's like...
Good, good. Yeah, it's tough, man. You know, especially when you're kind of just going about this without a script or anything like that. It's tough to break some of that stuff where you're pausing and you're like,
Yeah. Yeah, and if you watch your old videos, you're like, oh my God. That's even true of, like, you know, some of the better broadcasters, like Ethan. If you watch his very first videos, they're funny. Like, he talked so differently. He said a bunch. He talked really quiet and close to the mic and softer kind of and stuff like that.
Yeah, yeah. It takes a while, you know. It really does. Shrek says, or asks, I should say, who are your favorite mystery writers and from where do you draw inspiration?
Yeah, good question. So real quick, for this one, the inspiration is like some horror, not exactly even mystery, but there's a horror movie called Demons 2, an Italian horror movie that all takes place in an apartment complex.
That's a good one, man. I like that one a lot.
Oh, cool. That's cool. You've seen that one. That's awesome. But if you know that, then you know a lot of the vibe this is going for. It's like that you're checking in with different characters. You're following them all. You're kind of seeing what they're up to throughout this chaos unfolds. And but then, yeah, mystery, which is a little more related to Cerberus, but I'm also very interested in mystery. And I don't know, like the inspiration off the top of my head. I mean, I have the Columbo box set. But that's like almost not mystery. Like we're saying, that's like dramatic irony. But I love Columbo.
It's still mystery. It's just a form of storytelling within it, where dramatic irony is just the audience knows an event that's playing out and the characters don't.
Yeah. So that is inspirational. I've watched a bunch of that. That's one too, or I almost think about it. I'm like, how is it that every episode is basically the same? But it never gets old. And I'm like, I don't know that answer to that question exactly. It's like they explore a different world every time, and that's fun. So they'll be like, this time it's Columbo on a like military base or whatever. So you get to see the ins and outs of the military base. And this time it's Columbo in a broadcasting station. So you see in and out of the broadcasting station. So that kind of stuff is fun. And then it's Columbo himself. He's always the unifying thing that basically never gets old.
Oh, yeah. It's more about the reactions than the action taking place. You know, I mean by that is you have all these different characters playing off of each other. You have a different scenario. You have, like you said, a different setting. And then you build in character quirks. You know, so it's one of those things where you can have kind of a formulaic setup in some respects, but still through the performances and the characters, you can still have something that feels fresh.
Yeah, yeah. And even Scooby-Doo's like almost like that, where it's like every episode's kind of same, but it's still a lot of fun. Everyone's different too, or how the characters play out. I could almost put Scooby-Doo as an influence. I have seen like almost every episode, but just as a kid, that's almost like down there in the subconscious kind of thing.
Oh, totally, man. I mean, Scooby-Doo, classic.
Yeah.
Absolutely. Yeah. We got another question here. Down Goes Solo says, does your story follow a single character, kind of like Four Rooms?
Not really. Or? Yeah. Right at the beginning. And that's like a motif almost, the way Four Rooms does it. You have the one character moving throughout the different stories.
Yeah, the bellhop. Yeah.
Yeah. And we do have a bellhop character and a pizza delivery guy character that serve roles sort of similar like that. But it's not a blatant motif that we follow. I'm trying to think if we do anything like that. Not exactly. It's mostly just like it's that type of story like Demons 2, where like you're just, it's almost like you could see a map of the building. You're like, you got some people here, some people here, some people here, and those are the survivors, and press go, and like a simulation almost. And actually, I did that a little bit with Earthbound. I've talked about this a little bit, but I have it, it's like a thing I kind of wrote down as a possible guide for if it fits the story, but you say the strategy is the story. So and I get that from Dawn of the Dead, where Dawn of the Dead is like, it's a zombie apocalypse. What's the story? Well, it's just how they survive. So they're like, okay, well, let's get to the helicopter. Let's fly out of here. We're almost out of gas. Let's park for the at the mall. Well, shit, the mall is actually kind of useful. Maybe we should just stay. So what do we got to do to make that happen? And that's like the entire movie is just what they do within that situation. And if one thing I like about that is that's almost like turning like a Dungeons and Dragons campaign into a story or whatever, but it's a lot more character based. And if you do that, you don't have plot holes, but not every story can be like that. But if you have like their characters are just doing, you know, what they want to do in their best interest every time, then it's not really like an opportunity for plot holes to appear necessarily.
Yeah, I agree. Everybody, I've got the links in the description of the show. If you do want to go check out Hotel Story, we'll put that up in just a minute. And also go subscribe to Narwhal's channel, too. I've got that link in the description as well.
Thanks.
Yeah, no problem. So when you're going out and getting artists together for your work, I got to be honest with you. The past couple of projects you've done, I thought that was yours and you were just tweaking and adjusting style, because that's how much the artists you're getting are kind of not aping your style, but it feels like it's a house style that you've got going on. And yeah, and that the artists, I don't know, how are you going about that? Are they tweaking their style to make it look like a house style? Is it a subconscious thing that's occurring? Are you actively scouting for people who kind of have a similar style?
Yeah, I think like me and Monica, we might be on the same spectrum. She's just better and more advanced. And so that could be a slight relation. And then she's drawing, this is for Cerberus, and then she's drawing my script. And then in the case of Jared, that one too, we're using a kind of, he and me, we are very related in how we draw. And then on that one, I did have a heavy role kind of like as an editor where my fingerprints are very much on the storytelling as well as Jared, or it's almost 50-50, even though he's the full artist, but we would pass everything through together, thumbnailing basically, and getting the storytelling right. So that will have like my feel to it with the pacing and stuff. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, Cerberus, that's interesting. And I do, there's something I'll see artists and I'll be like, ooh, I like that. And I can see stuff that's way different that I like, but that also, if I see something super different, I would be less confident writing for them. Where if I see something I like and I'm like, oh, I can tell it's at least on the same spectrum as my stuff, then I feel a lot more confident writing for them, I think, too.
Yeah. Because you can almost help to visualize it a bit better.
Because
it's kind of like your style.
Yeah, like I guess a style that I am not that, I don't dabble in at all, would be like even like a Jim Lee superhero style, like even Dan Dahl, like in Comicsgate, like I love his art, but it's very classic 90s superhero. And I would be kind of intimidated to write something for him. And not that I wouldn't do it, but I might even try and think like I'd have to write a slightly different script to like, because some of my scripts, they're a little bit more storyboardy almost, which can be like a negative term. A positive term-ish could be like a little more cinematic style, but it's where it's a little bit more like flowy, animation-y even or whatever. Whereas a lot of the classic 90s superhero stuff is more like for how you might approach an action scene, it could be like a 5-page punch, kick, punch, kick. And that actually, say with some gags and some ebb and flow and 2 steps forward, 1 step back or whatever. Mm-hmm. Or it could be like one or two super badass drawings. And that's kind of more what it's about. That's how I picture in my head, at least. It's the more 90s style.
Yeah, when the dynamism is really pushed up.
Yeah. And it's more about one really good drawing of an awesome punch rather than like a duck and he used like something to block that was kind of clever. So the audience is like, oh yeah.
Yeah, it's just like before and after. So like in the swing of a punch, it'd be like the, you know, the potential energy kind of thing gearing up, and then the follow through, and you see the, oh, you know, you're knocked off.
Yeah.
Yeah. As opposed to, like you said, the little nuances more of a fight. And there were some artists that did that, as mostly, I guess, through the 80s, where I saw a lot of that stuff. Frank Miller was pretty good at that.
Yeah.
With the book that you've got currently, what are you finding are some of the difficulties with this story as opposed to the previous stories you've worked on? Because there's always a new different hurdle, a new obstacle every single time you want to approach a new story.
Yeah. Well, this one, potentially, I'm always really focused on readability and flow. And it's sometimes hard to judge it via feedback, because if you picture a reading experience, I think sometimes there can be little things that make kind of a big difference between how people feel about it. And so it's like, while working with Jared, getting almost the reader psychology to the point where it's part one of a two-part story, and we want it to feel complete. And like, even Cerberus, there's some complaints about that. They're like, it ended too abruptly. And then you can't exactly, I don't know what you can do to even fix that. And in some ways you're like, well, that's good that at least they're anticipating part two then. But
that wasn't a one and done. There's a part two.
Yeah. And this one too. So, but getting that, I'm trying a little bit harder with this one to get a complete experience for part one. And then also we're trying to do some of those cinematic, I call them gags, but like even one more example is, there's, you know how you can't breathe in the mirror room, like in the mirror world, like I said, there's a fight scene where that's how a guy wins a fight, is he ends up drowning a guy in a mirror. So he like grabs his head, sticks it in a mirror. And like, so that's kind of a cool little rule used, not the way you'd expect. And so we want that to feel super cool when the audience is reading it. And it's just making sure that all the clarity and flow is there, that they're getting some of these gags. And we've been that with this, we've been doing a fair amount of like tweaking as we go, and it's completely done, but we're still tweaking it. So this is Earthbound One was like my most tweaked comic ever. And it did help a lot. Like I got some from an early version of Earthbound, I got some very harsh feedback from a couple readers. It was like early CG, and I don't remember where these guys went. I don't think they're around anymore, but they were funny. They gave me some feedback that was like kind of mean, but in hindsight too, it's like, yes, this is good. This is just what I need, especially on a first book. And I implemented everything they said, and I was getting better and better reviews as I was doing it. And we're putting this through a little bit of a similar ringer. I'm sending it out to a lot of people early, because it's kind of an advantage to have it completely done while it's crowdfunding. And it's going to be crowdfunding for 4 months, because I want people to have the opportunity to back it. Whereas sometimes when the art's done, I tend to run a really quick campaign, move on to the next one. I'm like, no, okay, this one, we're going to stick it around, have the opportunity, and we're going to like let it stew. And we're going to sit there and see and make sure. And I emailed Jared just the other day. I was like, Jared, I think we should add one scene right at the end to give a little bit more of this full, wholesome experience, not wholesome, but whole meal experience for the book. And we're going to give kind of a little more big detail, big reveal. That actually reminded me when I thought of that. That's a little bit like the kind of thing that Mark Miller does. Like, he'll often have his form of cliffhanger that works really nice is, he has the huge like acceleration reveal of the story on the last page, and they're like, ah, crap, that's changes a lot of things. Now I got to see where this goes.
Yeah, I mean, that used to be a pretty commonplace thing with episodic ongoing stories. It's the same thing I'm doing even with King Cryptid, where on the last page, so you get most of the issue play out, but then on the last page is something that will simultaneously tie up the story, but also hint at stories to come, or sometimes hint at something that's immediately going to be almost like you're having a cliffhanger.
Yeah, that's cool.
Completed still the whole story. Yeah,
that like Buffy the Vampire Slayer did that really well back in the day.
Everything did that really well for so long. It's strange. A lot of the storytelling nowadays is kind of, I mean, they'll still kind of have that cliffhanger feel, the ones that do it right. But you don't really get a sense of a complete story was told within whatever it is, an issue, an episode, whatever.
I heard a term that, I forget where I heard it. It might even been like Spielberg or something, but they were saying there's something called the sucker's cliffhanger. And that's like a bad cliffhanger, but those are the ones where it just kind of, the guy randomly almost falls off a cliff, and it goes, tune in next week to see whether or not he falls off the cliff.
That's like the Batman 66 thing, right?
Yeah.
Like they're tied up or whatever, and it's like, how will our heroes escape this time?
Yeah, and then when you do tune in, they get out of it right away, and then they're just back to their regular story. So, you know, they just tacked it on just to give you one little thing.
My favorite one was when they were, I'm pretty sure they were like humming, because it needed to be a certain frequency. It was like, we got to hit a certain, you know, like a F sharp or something, and let's hum, and it'll trigger the thing, and we'll get out of the... You know, so it was, you always knew they were going to get out, but it was like, well, how are they going to get out? You know, and then once they get, well, what's going to happen with that? And then how's that going to wrap up? You know, so, but yeah, it was obviously a simpler time in terms of storytelling on that level, aimed at a specific kind of storytelling, not an audience, but a specific outcome, a specific tone. For the tone of your book, is this something that, is like, you know how a lot of these murder mysteries, they'll have that kind of sardonic humor, it's kind of darker, there's a sense of almost as if people are, I don't know, like they have no remorse for anything that's occurring. You get what I'm talking about, where everything's kind of like, hey, we killed
them. That's a good point. So I've noticed this, that it is basically a balance between humor and stakes. Where, and this can apply to multiple genres, but in this case, it's pretty much horror, actually, is the genre. This is like a kind of a horror story, like with a witch and whatever. But you can make it more horror comedy, but then the stakes go down the more you like joke around. People are like, yeah. Like Marvel, for example, for superhero, they were kind of pushing it too far in the humor. You lose the stakes. Yeah. And you can go all the way the other way. And that's honestly like not that bad. It's high stakes are way better than high humor, I kind of feel like, for most things. Like
where everyone's so like, stuff happened, so
yeah,
let's make a joke.
Yeah. So yeah, and this, I wonder, we do, one thing we sort of do with it is kind of like a cognitive dissonance reaction at first to the horror. So there's a lot of like people not even commenting because they don't even know what to think. And then we do have, it's kind of a trope, but you have it, kind of our angel character does explain to some of the survivors. They all get to one room finally, and they're like, all right, you seem to know what's going on. You got to tell us. And he kind of tells them a little bit what's going on. He says, you know, like, there's a witch in this hotel. Some of that's in the trailer. Like, she's cast a spell, and if it's going to kill everyone, it's going to mean certain doom for almost everyone here if she completes it.
Okay. You know what? Let's play that trailer. Let's check it out. Let me bring this back up here. All right, let me get rid of the banner.
So this is kind of basically full animation, a little limited animation, but me and Jared animated this, and we learned a lot doing it. It's still, we're going to try and do an actual short film together sooner or later too, but.
Okay, awesome. All right, let's play this and make it full screen.
Synthesize.
You must be hamming it up for a big tip.
Sin. The. Size. Three simple syllables. They may not mean much to you now, but by the end of this night, they will.
There's a witch in this hotel. My mission is to stop her. Could mean certain doom for many if she completes her spell.
We're bringing that knowledge back with us to the real world, but we're giving it a special touch.
Don't suppose I know you.
Adrian.
You're a famous party pooper.
At your service.
Yeah, so at the end there, you know, she's talking to a pizza guy who has a sword through his chest. He's kind of nailed to this big post. And because he's possessed, he can talk. So there's some humor that comes from that situation, but it's not necessarily lowering the stakes, because this is like the power of that angel that he can possess dead bodies. And that's another of the rules that, as the story goes on, that gets more and more explored in fun ways. It's actually in part two. Again, this is not exactly spoilers. You can kind of imagine this, but like that power, I had that idea for a power a while ago, and I had another character I was thinking about doing. But you could imagine like, if it's one versus like more like 10 people, even like say he has a knife, you throw the knife at that dude, kill him, then you become that guy, pull the knife out of your own head, stab the guy next to you, become him, pull the knife out of your own head, stab him. So like there's kind of fun action that comes from that power. And interesting. So we're putting that in here too.
Oh, how long were you developing this story?
So it was sitting there unfinished for a long time. It kind of got reworked, me and Jared, probably two-month period of us heavy back and forth via email writing it. And actually the writing process was kind of fun because I had Jared write, I gave it, this is a little bit like how me and your boy Zach sometimes do things with our collaboration, except I was more in the your boy Zach shoes. Jared would be the one in my shoes. But we do a meeting, I give him a super detailed outline, and then he goes and writes it, and then he passes it to me, and then I kind of rewrite it to change just anything I want if I'm trying to think something that's harder to communicate to him of what I need. Instead of endless back and forth, I just do my version. I send it back to him so he can kind of read it and see what I did. I usually don't change that much. And that way we got a lot of the fun things that Jared brought to it. Like he brought a lot of character and dialogue stuff that's really fun. And it's outside of my wheelhouse too. Like it's just different than I would have done, which I really enjoyed. But then I got to do a lot of what I like to do, which is like kind of focusing on that strategy is the story stuff, some structural stuff. Oh, I always do try and prioritize the kind of narrative drive. Like the goal is to get people to read it in one sitting, you know? So yeah, there's ways that you can kind of do that.
Yeah. To keep it as a page turner moving. Yeah. Along. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Let's see. We got a question here from Shrek. It says, did you study writing, literature, drama as part of secondary and I'm guessing and or post-secondary education?
Yeah, I went to the Evergreen State College, which is kind of famous for being crazy, but they got super crazy after I left.
Where is that located?
In Olympia, Washington.
Okay.
And yeah, it's like Brett Weinstein was teaching there. That was that whole story that people might remember. But I did a sculptural art history degree. And so it wasn't that related to writing. I learned a lot. I had sort of a mentor figure in my 20s, just a buddy, but I was moving to Texas and I checked the Craigslist for Austin for illustration work. And he was trying to get a script off the ground. So he needed an illustrator just to help sell it kind of. And he worked at a video rental store, like a boutique one, kind of like Scarecrow Video in Seattle. Like they have everything, all the super rare movies. And he was a movie buff. He'd seen a billion movies. And I was like 22. And I was like, you know, I'm a writer too. And he read some of my scripts at the time. They're all terrible. And he gave me like a movie to watch every week. And I would watch it. And then we co-wrote some scripts together. I was illustrating his scripts. So we're kind of have this quid pro quo thing. And I was kind of getting better and better, but it took a while. And then when I'm 37 now, it was when I was 27 was when I first wrote Earthbound. And when I was looking back, that ended up being like my 15th movie script. And that was the first one where you read it like 3 months later and you're like, oh, this one isn't that bad. Cause a lot of times you read them later and you're like, ah, crap. When you're getting better, it's always like that. You can't tell as you're doing it. That's kind of like this force that keeps us going too. When we're like, you think you're the shit, but you actually suck. But then you just kind of keep going. And there were times where I kind of set down the pen.
Hopefully you learn.
Yeah. Hopefully. Yeah. I know at some point I saw, what was it? Cause I was kind of into twist endings and I saw The Usual Suspects and I was like, oh, I'll never be able to write a twist that cool. And I quit writing for like a year, but then I inevitably got inspiration to write something and picked it back up again. But that was kind of where I learned the most from writing was doing movie scripts, watching old movies, working with this gentleman that we were just collaborating on some art projects that eventually led to Earthbound that eventually became my first big comic.
Well, that's the funny thing about putting stories together too, is that as you're doing it, it's easy to critique what other people are doing and point out what you don't like about it and things like that. And then eventually you learn how to quantify what you would do to change it to make it better. But for your own stuff, sometimes people become very oblivious to what their shortcomings are, or they don't want to admit it, or they, you know, they say, oh, well, people just don't get it. But eventually you get to a point where hopefully if you've been doing it long enough, you can look back and then you can really critique and be and make those self edits. And then you actually can take that skill set to what you're currently doing. But it takes time. And that's the thing that's that I find. I've seen a lot of people send in submissions over the years to Alterna. And I can really tell when people are doing this, you know, it's their first year, maybe they're doing something, as opposed to they've been doing it for a while and they're really making the effort to be more self-critical in a way that benefits their story. But there's sometimes submissions come through and I can really tell when it's someone who's starting out because they'll send like an 8-page submission and I'll read the 8 pages and I'm thinking, I have no idea what the hell's going on. And that's, for 8 pages and you have no idea what's going on. Character names haven't been mentioned. You know, you have no sense of what the bearings are within the story. You don't know what's going on, the motivations, anything, even sense of time within the story. Like, where is this in the past, present day, future? There's some stories that get set up and it's just, you know, and then so I'll talk to the creator and they go, oh, we'll find out more by like the third issue. And I'm like,
give
you 3 issues, man.
Yeah. That's valuable that you're in that position. I think that's very like interesting and cool that you get to kind of see that view of the industry of kind of people, these submissions and stuff. But what that reminded me of too is, you know, manga, they have that cool situation where it's all in the magazine and if you aren't good, you get cut kind of. So it's like you have to be great to even get picked up. And their pace to get going is so fast that it's almost like too fast, but it's good inspiration. I was thinking of a Death Note. I read the first chapter of that because I love the anime and watched it. But then I read the first chapter and it's funny. I think by 8 pages, he has the Death Note and has like written the first name in it. And maybe the first person's died from it. All the rules are explained. I'm like, how did you do it in 8 pages? It almost feels like a little bit like too fast, but you're like, well, like hats off to you for.
Yeah. Like, then you're diving right into the story. And the thing is there's two types of people that do that when they're starting off and that's the first kind, but the second kind that has a little bit more potential to be edited if they're open to it, throws everything at you.
Yeah.
You're getting overloaded with information. But the thing is that you can edit down from that. So if they're open to it and more receptive, and then they can let the story breathe, you can work a lot with that, you know. But the other person who really wants it to have that slow burn, it's just there's, you know, one or two balloons of dialogue per page, and you're just like, what is going on? What is happening? You know, but the other person comes in, it just, they're just throwing up the story right all over you. If someone can come in there and they're, like I said, they're open to it, you can edit them to a point where you can have something interesting and cohesive and the pacing could be great. But John, it's tough, right? Because issue one needs to be your best, not even actually the first 2 pages of your issue number one. You don't have much time to hook someone. I think if you can get some kind of atmosphere and premise set up within the first 3 pages, you're pretty golden. You know, and depending on how you're telling your story, you know, so if you've got a long form graphic novel, because how many pages is Hotel Story Part 1?
124.
Oh, so yeah, you got a big book there, man. You know, so if you're doing that within 5 to even 10 pages where you're really establishing everything, and this way people are familiar and they go, okay, well, I get a sense of it. It's kind of like watching a movie in the first 15 minutes. If in the first 15, you know, after that first 15, you're still completely and utterly lost, that's going to be tough.
Yeah.
You know? But yeah, so, and you'll notice that too with a lot of classic iconic films, within those first 15 minutes, you know the setting, you know the motivations of a character, and you don't know the whole extent of it, but you get what they're about, you know their name, and they have already done something that's a character-defining moment, at least within the eyes of the viewer. You know, or in your case, the eye of the reader.
Yeah. Yeah, that's cool. And you can sometimes be aware of that guiding hand, but sometimes it's like, as an audience member, it's very calming to know you're in good hands.
Yeah.
So they might do a trope or something that is even a cliche, but if they're like, it feels like they know what they're doing, that feels better than you have no idea what's going on. And you can kind of sense that it's their first script or whatever, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it's a magic act with storytelling, you know, is all kinds of flashy misdirection.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
So that you can constantly direct people here while you're setting up something over here and letting the magic play out. And then, you know, you let the viewer have that that negative space interaction I was talking with you about in terms of the interactivity for the reader, where there's negative space in art, which is not obviously the positive space, which is the image. You get the negative space that's not filled in, and you do the same thing with writing and storytelling, and you allow the reader to draw some of their own conclusions based on what you're presenting, as opposed to spelling everything out. Yeah,
that's a great concept. Yeah, I'm really excited about King Cryptid. We've talked a little bit about this, but I love that you have the episodic and extended story kind of combined, and you get to build it, and you're doing everything you're saying. You're putting all your money exactly where your mouth is, and it's like years of experience of running this company and seeing these, reading comics.
Yeah, even just 17 years of working with creators, you know, and seeing a lot of this stuff come through, and sometimes being the only person that they have something to bounce an idea off of, and then everything else that comes with that. I couldn't have done this. I couldn't even have done this 10 years ago with this kind of story. I know exactly what I need to know at the point that I need to know it. And then 10 years from now, I can only imagine how much more the people watching, the creators that are out there, how much further along they'll get as well.
Yeah. But, well,
it takes time.
One other real quick thing too. Yeah. So King Cryptid, I'm pretty excited about it. Just if you look at all the, like the whole landscape, there's not that many people doing one character and building on it continuously for a long period of time. Not at a kind of fast rate. So like if in 10 years you might be on or issue 60 or 50 or something.
Yeah.
You
yeah. Know?
Like there, nobody else, I think literally nobody else is doing that. And that is like kind of like one of the most awesome ways to create the culture, I think, is with that.
Oh yeah. Yeah. I mean, you need those characters and those stories and that sense of an understanding between the reader and the world that they're in when they're reading a story that's like that with an ongoing, you know, I think that's so important. I think that's lacking incredibly within the indie comic sphere in general, and not just current indie comics, but if you think about all the indie comics that have lasted up until this point, there's only a handful of creators that are still working relatively with the same characters.
Yeah.
You know, so yeah, you got Billy Tucci with She, you get Polito with Lady Death. And then even Ethan, who, you know, he had Cyberfrog, but then got into the mainstream comics career. But now he's going back to Cyberfrog. You know, I'm sure in 10, 15, 20 years, he's going to be continuing to do more of that as well. So I think a lot of those stories that revolve around characters, a specific world and setting, bringing in other characters, I think that stuff is great. I love seeing that kind of stuff.
Yeah, it's something I want to do that I haven't done yet. And I'm kind of going down a different path, but it's I want to do that too, like what you're doing. It's too many things that I want to do is part of the problem.
Yeah,
but
do you have an idea for something like that?
I have one that
about
could,
that with you.
Yeah, that could be a little bit of a more extended possible series, and it's Percival and his Holy Grail kind of quest, with it being kind of the idea that we aren't going to necessarily even see him complete the quest. It's all just various of him getting it. He's trying to get it back to King Arthur or whatever, but things keep going wrong. The Grail messes with him, so like it will disappear, like on purpose, kind of to test him. So he's kind of, part of it is he's almost playing chicken with this cup. That's the idea that got me excited about it. I was like, oh, you can kind of add a character to the Grail. Like, I think there's a part, like, because the Grail will heal any wound, but if he uses it on himself, it will disappear, and he has to kind of go back and start over and lose a year or whatever. But so he doesn't want it. But there's a part that I have in my head. I haven't even written it yet, but he's like surrounded by bad guys with one dude in a house, and they're like, he's like crippled because he's been injured. And the guy's like, we need to heal you. We'll lose the Grail, but then we can at least survive this battle. And then we'll find the Grail later. We'll figure it out from there. And he's like, okay, I guess go get the Grail. So he goes to get the Grail. It's gone. It already disappeared and fucked him because it just like messes with him.
That's
so then he
two
has to
narwhal two.
Oh shit. Sorry. Damn it. I'm so sorry. I'll get better. I'm bad at this aspect of streaming. I'll get better. I promise I'll work on it. I'm actually a little embarrassed. Sorry.
We're going to have the censors coming down on us, man. The FCC is going to crush this channel.
Yeah. Sorry, Chet. But I was getting into that little. But yeah, that could be multiple stories within that world of Percival just being a guy. But
yeah, who knows, yeah. Yeah, that would be interesting to see you tackle something like that, to see you tackle an ongoing series with a character and their continual adventures that they have, a serialized form of storytelling for you. I'd like to see you do something like that. We'll see.
I like the 20-page to 44, 22 to 44 kind of page stories, too.
You were speaking to me, man, with that. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, one random thing sort of related to that is I've been reading Cerebus by Dave Sim, which is kind of a famous book. I didn't particularly realize, but a lot of people list that as like
it's very famous. Yeah.
A great book. Yeah. And it's pretty fun. Like that's him doing one character for a long time, a little bit like what we're talking about. And that first phone book volume, you can feel him. It's all individual, like almost he's making fun of Conan, like just little individual short stories, ideas. But then towards the end, about issue 20, they start to be like 3-issue stories, 4-issue stories. And then I think in volume 2, which I'm not to that yet, but everyone says that's amazing. And that's when it's like 40-issue stories or something where he's like, he just really gets into the world. He starts telling these kind of epic tales, but then each issue can still be its individual bite-sized completionist thing. But
yeah. And you can have organic growth occur within your story that way. You know, the world building and character building that has a purpose. Because there's a lot of world building that sometimes feels like it's meant to put off plot from developing.
Yeah.
But if you're doing it right, the world building is the plot. There is a payoff constantly by introducing characters, introducing new elements to the world, new aspects to the main character or a side character that comes in, and then seeing how they play off of each other. You know, you can get new villains introduced or a questionable characters that you're not certain of. I mean, that's the kind of stuff that made comics some of the, you know, it's just one of the most funnerest ever mediums that there could be.
Yeah. They sometimes you can sense like the filler in anime or whatever. You're like, oh, this is a filler. Yeah. But at the flip side too, there's like writing for the trade or the super slow paced writing that a lot of modern Marvel might do, where they aren't even conscious of that one issue. It should be like, it should be a satisfying thing, and it isn't. That it's like 3 random scenes and then it ends. And definitely getting away from that, getting back to kind of what you're doing with King Cryptid, I think is like a great step.
Oh, thank you, man, appreciate that. That's why it breaks my heart, because the chat's hurting, man. Their virgin ears are burning.
Oops. I heard
censor you.
I'm so sorry, chat. So, I can't believe I said 2 F-bombs. Someone said too, they're like, Narwhal's demeanor doesn't seem like he would be that kind of guy.
I'm going to have to do this to you. I'm sorry.
You know what? There should be like a tip jar where you got to put money in if you swear or something.
Someone had suggested that in the chat earlier. Maddock, thank you for the $1.99. Says, my favorite comics combo collab, Gnar Pete.
I'd be down it for you. It would be a fun side thing because you got King Cryptid and that's your baby. I almost hinted. I was like, would you ever look at working with having someone else write that? And you're like, no, it's all me. I'm like, fair enough.
Yeah. That's a tough one, right? So when it comes to King Cryptid stories, I don't recommend anybody, and not just for King Cryptid, but I think it's just a good rule of thumb. You shouldn't try to jump into crossover territory until a character has been around long enough, you know, so that the audience can also have an understanding of this character, and that the person creating it has enough source material, reference material to work from it. Mm-hmm. You know, so for King Cryptid, I wouldn't want to do anything like that with anyone until like 5 years from now. Mm-hmm. So even if I was like, okay, you know, if you want to make a story, Narwhal, of King Cryptid, and you will get it, and it came out on a Wednesday, or as like a back matter extra featurette or something in an issue, I wouldn't want to even do that till we got like 20 issues out.
Yeah. Yeah. But that's the thing. Maybe in 5 years, I bet we'll still be around. So maybe to the person who commented that. But maybe something else too. You never know how these things
go. You never know. Never know. Yeah. But all right, I'm going to put the StreamYard here, the StreamYard link. If you guys want to join, if you've got a question or comment for Narwhal, my guest tonight, Per Berg.
I see Aldeon in the chat. What's up, Aldeon? Hop in here and ask me a question, brother.
Yeah, come on in and don't be shy. So there's the link. Feel free and say hello. Let's see. I've got a couple questions here in the chat. I want to make sure that they're not. I'm not reading that, Alex, VRB. the past master says Pete Wall.
It sounds funny.
Narp.
Yeah, you. Pete in Wall. In the comment, more and more people call me Per Berg. I'm like, I might move back to that at some point. I don't know. Narwhal is cool, but Per Berg's fine too. I don't know.
Pete and Per. It's like Pete and Pete.
Yeah, Per is like the Swedish kind of edition of Pete.
For Pete. Sort of. Yeah, for yeah. Peter. Yeah. All right, we got a. There he is, right there in the green room. I see you. I'll let you on. We got two people now in the green room. All right, so we're gonna do the new thing here. Two question / comment minimum. This way we can keep the show moving along too. All right, here we go. Welcome, Alex, to Comic Book Radio.
Hey. Hey, Narwhal, Pizza Maddie. Yeah.
What's up?
You said a minimum of two questions, which is good because I have like 20 Dungeons and Dragons questions.
I figured.
No, I'm kidding. first, does anyone other than the witch and the liminal angel possess any special powers to start with?
No.
Or do they discover or develop special powers over the course of the story?
Yeah, for the humans, they're just kind of make and do pretty regular. And then the witch has one assistant who is a little bit super powered, and they call in, they do a summoning, and some that's again some of that like structural stuff that changes the board or whatever. But about halfway into the story, about something gets summoned, and that's kind of cool. And then the angel has a boss who's kind of a funny cigar-smoking angel, and he's hanging out outside, but he can't go in. So he's kind of trying to help a little bit from the outside.
Nice. Is there anything special about the hotel or the location itself that draws the witch to it? Or is it just opportunistic due to the large number of people or maybe an isolated location?
Yeah, the hotel, it has a backstory and a little lore to it, that of the ownership and like the ground it's buried on, of course, that kind of stuff.
Okay.
And the history actually goes back like over 1,000 years. And so there is some of that.
If there's any spoilers, Narwhal, don't give them away just in case. I know you want to answer questions.
Yeah, yeah, definitely. Yeah. Yeah.
No, nothing's too bad spoilers yet, I don't think so.
Okay. Real quick, and again, if you can't answer this, because it's a spoiler, are the zombies under the witch's control or allies to her in some way, or do they hinder everyone equally?
They're more on her side. She can't communicate with them via like mind reading or anything, or like hive mind. They have to get orders, and they all end up speaking caveman talk. So we kind of had some fun with that where, so they're still like, they're like, you know, bad guys in Die Hard or whatever. They're like, you know, we think they might be on floor two, go check it out, floor two. But because they've all been turned into these zombie people, they're like, me go second floor, she say, you go, you stay, and stuff like that.
Excellent. Well, thank you very much. I won't take any more of your time. Thank you again, Pete, Narwhal. Catch you guys later.
No,
thanks, Alex. Good to talk to you. First time I've chatted with Alex in person. He's always around. He's a great guy on the stream.
There you go.
Yeah, man.
Bringing people together on Comic Book Radio. That's what it's all about. Have a great night, Alex.
Good night.
Hidden Hand Media says, what happens at the end? Well, just kidding.
All right. We got another guest here. Aldeon, what's up?
Hey, Aldeon, what's up, man?
Hey, good to see you. Good to see you. Hey, I've been reading Earthbound. I started with Grand Prix.
Oh, cool.
Because I wanted to, you know, see what that was like.
An experiment.
I've read Grand Prix, and I've read Earthbound, the Volume 1. I have not read Volume 2 yet. So
okay.
And I gotta say, I mean, I'm enjoying the story, but I am a little confused at really what's going on. Are these, you know, I'm trying to figure out, are these space aliens? Are they interdimensional? Are the, you know, the whiz kid, are they humans? Or, you know, what, I'm trying to figure out what they are. I don't quite have a concept of what that is yet.
Yeah, I wonder what the, if there's a, like a prototype for what it is, but it's like humans, people that look like humans and even straight up humans are kind of on other planets too. In this
okay,
universe.
Well, that makes sense to me. Yeah. You know, it's kind of like the theory of, okay, a bubble's round no matter which planet it's going to be on, you know?
Yeah. So like WizKid,
yeah, he's like technically the panspermia theory.
Yeah, he's technically an alien, but he's human.
Okay, you know what I mean? Okay. So he's genetically compatible. So if he mates with a human on Earth, that's compatible. You know, there's not going to be any complications from it.
No complications. Yeah.
Okay. All right. It's starting to come together. And then the Grand Prix, you know, before I read any of this stuff, I was thinking the Grand Prix was some kind of a race or something like that. But it seems pretty obvious that that's something that's going to be revealed in later issues. That's kind of some sort of a surprise. We're not really supposed to know what exactly the Grand Prix is. It's all hinted at so far.
Yeah. It's just this big event that, you know, people are entering. They need big, good fighters for. So it's kind of, you know, you see what it is when you get there. And the next issue of Grand Prix goes into Temple One, and you see, like, kind of what's happening.
I'll do a follow-up to that question. Gnarl, do you like putting together an ensemble of characters in your stories, or do you like to focus instead on a couple of characters or just one character?
Good question. So that, for Hotel Story, that would almost be a better answer to your earlier question about what's the challenge, because that definitely, it's totally an ensemble story, and mm-hmm. that was a challenge. And Earthbound is a little bit outside the box too, because it was rock, paper, scissors. It kind of has three main characters, which is not even necessarily, I don't know if that's like good or bad. It's like different. So people do kind of like that about it, but it's like, I think a really good versus evil story is kind of theoretically better than a rock, paper, scissors story. But Earthbound is a little bit more like rock, paper, scissors.
Yeah, I think if you were to do an ongoing, I would say that, you really juggle the character voices and personalities well. Sometimes people put that stuff together and all the characters end up kind of acting, reacting, sounding the same.
Yeah.
But you do a good job of making them feel like individuals.
Yeah, thanks. That's cool. Yeah, I'm kind of inspired talking to you. I'm like, dude, I want to do the ongoing. That would be so fun.
Yeah.
To get something like that going. But yeah.
Well, I like the Earthbound story. It's got a good vibe to it. You know, it's something that I think would work very well as an animated series that you could watch. I don't know, sci-fi or something. Some channel, some really good sci-fi that you've had a stressful day. You come home and watch that, and like, yeah, I'm into this. This is good stuff. I like the ships. You know, with the bully ships, the dream catchers. I like the different ships.
Thanks.
I'm excited to see more of those.
Thanks. Yeah, it's got a okay mix, because sci-fi is kind of broad of what it can be, and Earthbound is kind of specific in that it's like kind of grounded, kind of earthbound, like, and then it's kind of some magic is sort of allowed. It's a little bit more like Star Wars. It's definitely less the hard sci-fi, but then some humor is allowed. So it's kind of this interesting mix that's kind of fun.
Yeah, the humor is definitely, it had me chuckling a few times, so it's pretty good.
Cool. Nice.
So I'm kind of in a weird limbo phase, because I haven't read Earthbound 2 yet. So I've read Grand Prix. I've read Part 1. So there's that little gap, which
we'll
solve pretty soon.
Thanks for taking one for the team and reading it in that order.
Yeah.
And it's good to hear that it's still at least, you know, like a fun experience. It doesn't ruin it necessarily reading it in that order.
Right. Look at, you know, because the Grand Prix is a part 1 of 6. And I thought it was going to be a completely unrelated story. I didn't realize how closely related they actually were. And so, and reading Grand Prix first and then seeing episode 1, like, oh, that's, you know, you have a lot of those aha moments.
Cool.
The way I did it, you know?
Yeah. That's fun. Nice.
That's where these things come from. Okay. You know, that sort of thing. So that's been a pleasant experience. I did want to ask about the Alterna comics. I got one of the bundles here, but
thank you, man.
You were talking about some sort of a, the comic that was your baby, and I don't think it is included in the bundle. This is separate. Can you tell me a little bit about that, please?
King Cryptid?
Yeah.
That one? Well, currently issues 5 to 9 are funding. 1 to 4 are available on alternacomics.com right now.
Okay.
So that revolves around the story of the supernatural hero known as King Cryptid. Now, he's based in the New England region, specifically the White Mountains of New Hampshire. He was cursed about 500 years ago, betrayed by his own people, turned into this monster. For about 100 or so years after that point, he was completely not in control of what he was doing. And in this monstrous form, he was killing and consuming everything in his path. So a lot of legend was built up around this kind of creature. This guy comes across this Wampanoag shaman eventually, who recognizes him and knows who he is from these stories and helps him out. So he gets his humanity back in that aspect of it, but he's on a path of redemption, and he's been on that ever since. The story right now with 1 to 4, it's an episodic ongoing series. We just dive right into it. We jump into the whole world, the whole story. We see King Cryptid. We're introduced to him in issue 1, where the Behemoth, which is actually interesting because I got the trading card in for the Behemoth the other day. The Behemoth, who is a hybrid creature, a human being merged with the DNA of the legendary Mothman, is being transported to whereabouts unknown.
Wow.
He basically makes the van tip over, escapes. King Cryptid helps the people who are transporting this creature. They don't know that they're transporting this creature. They're hired. They don't ask questions. They just do what they're told. He rescues them, takes them out of the van before it explodes. The next day, Victor Lugo comes in. Victor Lugo is a cryptid. He's a bounty hunter for hire, but he works for this organization. And this shadowy organization that's behind a lot of the stuff going on that King Cryptid is noticing that are occurring in the region, they are basically doing various things, bad things. It's an emerging, it's a weird thing that's emerging around the New Hampshire area, where it's taking black budget science and dark magic and combining it. And King Cryptid's noticing a lot of this stuff happen. 30 years or so of relative peace and calm, and now he's noticing that there's odd things occurring at a very fast pace. So he's not comfortable with that. He's doing something about it, and he's trying to make his little corner of the world better for those around him, and obviously for himself, because he feels like he kind of took a step back. He used to help out a lot more, and we're going to get to like flashback issues and stuff like that too, where he's about 500 or so years old. He used to help out a lot more outside of his region, but took a step back because he thought that, am I actually doing anything? Am I actually making an impact? He kind of had like a It's a Wonderful Life kind of a moment, and we touch upon that in issue 6. And he doesn't really think he's doing anything that great. And around like the early 90s or so, he takes this hiatus where he's just going to go into his self-seclusion in the White Mountains of New Hampshire. And he realizes that those 30 or so years where he did that, he actually was doing a lot of good. And because he took a step back and didn't want to do anything anymore and just was like, the rest of the world, nuts to it, whatever, I'm going to just concern myself with what's happening here, it allowed for this evil to grow right under his nose. So we're seeing every single episode, it's a complete story. It's a monster of the issue episode, but there's also a lot of stuff with continuity throughout the whole series that stuff ties together, stuff builds. So if you're into a lot of that kind of old school comic book feel, where there's new characters introduced all the time, new settings, new scenarios, you're seeing some recurring characters throughout the course of the series, you'll really dig King Cryptid. And if you're into paranormal history, if you're into cover-ups, conspiracies, monsters, mysteries, all that stuff, you'll really, really like King Cryptid. So, yeah, check it out.
Are you getting into DUMS at all? You know, the deep underground military bases?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Now, I'll tell you, my father was had a high security clearance in the U.S. Navy. He was a P-3 Orion pilot, but he was also involved in development of certain technologies and things like that. But he told me, he shouldn't have told me, but he told me anyway, that there was an instance where there was a particular base they were flying, and this mountain just opened up And in that mountain was an elaborate underground base, and that was an aerial entrance to it. And they flew the P3 right in there, and it closed.
Yeah, there's
back
a lot of stories.
That stuff's
about.
Real, is yeah. what I'm saying.
Yeah, in fact, the organization. It's speaking of dramatic irony, the readers will know about it more than King Cryptid will be knowing about it. And it's called the New England Cryptid Research Organization. It's a whole front. And it's actually a front within a front within a front. But we don't get to that stuff till later on. But the whole front of the New England Cryptid Research Organization, they've got a gift shop. They've got this area on top of the Mount Washington Observatory where you can go there and visit and whatever. And it's just, you know, oh, we do cryptid research. And we, you know, we just document various reportings and whatever. They are doing some pretty horrific things. Like I said, the reader's going to know more about some of the stuff that's occurring as opposed to King Cryptid, but he eventually does find out more and more and more about it. The first four issues kind of establish a bunch of different things. It establishes his character, his power set, the world around him, a couple of characters as well. And then 5 to 9, we really see King Cryptid fully latch on to the concept that this isn't just a coincidence. This isn't just weird stuff that's occurring in this region. This is purposeful, and this is horrible, and it needs to be stopped. So by the end of issue 9, we really see him confront something that occurs, that it hits a nerve with him, because he finds out that there's stuff being done to kids.
Cool. Yeah, I love it. I am a backer. I'm going to be jumping in. I actually Thank still you, haven't man. Read it. I just heard of you pitch it, but...
And that's the fun thing, too, with the series. You can get in on issue 8, 9, 20, 30 when we go down the road and not be lost when you're reading the story. It'll make references to past stories and things like that, but you won't be lost when you're reading and enjoying the one issue being presented. So,
yeah. That's awesome. Now, I want to ask about the art on King Cryptid, right? Is it all black and white? Is it color? Do you have a different
color? We bounce around. It's mostly in color.
Okay.
But some issues, story to story, it's generally a different artist, but I bring back artists.
Okay.
It's rare that we'll have a story where, like, issue 8 and 9, let's say, would be the same artist. You know, unless it's, and I'm not doing story arcs anymore. I was going to do one for 10, 11, and 12 and make it like a three-parter, but instead I'm just going to make a king-size one issue for issue 10. But with the issues, depending on the tone of the story, depending on the feel, because it bounces around between sci-fi, horror, action, adventure.
That's
there's
awesome.
Different, yeah, there's different kinds of feels and tones of each story. Some of them are more all ages. There's a flashback issue with issue 3 that follows a bunch of kids who we see them as adults, and they play a very big part in the series, but we got a flashback and establish first what they were doing in 1984 in Lincoln, New Hampshire. When they come across King Cryptid for the first time and how that impacts their life. And we see them again in issue 8 in 1987 when something very, very impactful happens to one of them that changes the rest of their lives forever. So we see them as adults and we see how things play out. But it's important that that stuff gets established so this way readers can get a sense of what's occurring. But yeah, we kind of skip around a bunch in terms of not the... It's always maintaining a serious tone, but we skip around in terms of like the genre being played up. So some issues will feel more like a certain genre than others. And if black and white is more conducive to bringing that story across, depending what issue, what artist I have on the issue, then I go with that.
Yeah, yeah. So black and white might be good for another dimension or a flashback or something like that. You know,
yeah,
this happened
in
1926. It's in black and white. You know.
Yeah, like issue 2, it takes place on the night of a new moon, which we had a new moon last night.
Yeah.
It takes place on that, and it's inside of King Cryptid's cave lair. The only light coming from it emanates from this cosmic spring that's inside of the lair. And he uses those restorative waters to heal up on the night of a new moon. Because on a full moon, his powers are at their fullest. On a new moon, they're at their lowest. He's got a cosmic moonstone that kind of helps him out with his... it augments his power set. So that kind of thing plays a big part, and that issue's black and white, number 2, because of the fact that it's only really being lit within the cave. It wouldn't have made too much sense to go full color with it, but we get to play up shadow and lighting very well.
Yeah.
In that. Nick Hunter does a tremendous job with that issue.
I was going to say, Nick Hunter and Christian Rossi are the two that I know, and they're both amazing. They're both, like, so good.
They're they're fantastic. But thank you so much, Aldeon, for being on here and for your questions for both me and Narwhal. Appreciate it, man.
Yeah, man.
Thanks, Aldeon. See you later, man.
Have a great night. All right, we got a couple people patiently waiting here for you. So let's get to Ronan. What's up, Ronan? Thank you for being here on Comic Book Radio.
Ronan, what's up, man? Uh-oh, wait, Ronan, you're muted or something. We can't hear you. Turn on your mic or plug it in or click on it.
Yeah, I still can't hear you. I hope
we could.
I wonder if it might be a mic thing. Yeah, like what Narwhal said.
If you click settings and mess with it there, maybe. Sorry about that, Ronan.
Let me see here.
I could try and read your lips.
Unmuted. Oh, man. All right, Ronan, I'm going to try to figure it out, and I'm going to put you in the back, and then I'll put somebody else on. See you in a minute.
Cool.
We got the Don. What's up, Don?
Don, what's up, Don?
What's up? What's up? What's up, Narwhal? Pete, how you y'all doing tonight?
Doing good. How are you?
All right, Narwhal, I got two questions for you, bro. Number one, let's assume I have never read any of your books. Because I haven't, sadly. What would be the best one to start with?
Yeah, so this week I'm opening for the first time my eBay store, so people are going to be able to buy all my stuff for the first time ever, because it's only been that you can buy whatever's crowdfunding at the time. And I'm up to, if you include Narzak, I think I'm up to like 15 books or something. So it's actually kind of crazy that, because it's been now 5, 6, 7 years CG.
Very cool.
Kind of a long time. But so I don't know. I think either Earthbound is kind of classic iconic, or Foreign Agent I also really like. That's an old one, but I particularly remember it fondly, as a good starting point to read. Those are both like my style, both like early work too. They're a little like, they feel very Narwhal-y, obviously.
Narwhal-y. Good. Mm-hmm. Put that in the lexicon. Okay, yeah. And the second question I have, what kind of drugs are you on to make such great stories all the time?
That's funny.
You don't need to answer that. Plead the fifth.
Yeah, I'll plead the fifth. I drink booze in my 20s.
Secret, Narwhal.
I don't even drink anymore, but getting a baseline of life experiences helps. That's something Mark Miller says about. He's like, he doesn't think young people can be necessarily very good writers, especially these days, because the generation, it's almost like kids aren't even moving out of their parents' house
to
22 or something or whatever. But yeah, like they're a little bit later in life, having a little more life experience helps.
No, man, I'm just breaking your balls. You're a genius. You're a bloody genius. I love everything you do. And I can't wait to read more from you. Pete, you're a legend, brother.
Mm-hmm. Oh, well, thank you.
And
Don's got his book launching soon too. So I'll have you on my channel. We can promote it, Don.
Let's reserve legend status for me in about 40 years and see what happens.
Hey, man, take it when you can get it, right? Oh, why I got you on here, Pete? When can I get on your show to pimp my book out and just talk trash with you?
Oh, man, you want to put me on the spot? Man,
damn,
oh, man.
Right. That's what it's all about.
Well, it's probably going to be December or January, because schedule's booked up. Yeah.
I can live with that. Well, I'll drop you a DM or something, okay?
All right. Take it easy, Don. Thank you for stopping by.
Ronan, get your mic fixed, bruh.
All right. Take it easy, Don.
You too, man.
All right, let's give Ronan another shot. Let's see how it goes.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
All right. I forgot I was in Discord, so my mic was being used.
Oh, classic.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
Okay, so I have a couple questions more on the technical side. So as a writer, I know you guys have lots of stories and characters running in your head at once. How do you determine which one to pluck out in follow through with?
Yeah, that's a good question. I'll go first really quick. I do keep like a little notebook where I kind of scribble the ideas, and I'll keep little lists and stuff. And I do, it's kind of, you're tracking the inspiration, so you'll feel it all of a sudden. You're like, this one, it kind of, it feels more pregnant, more ready. And a lot of times though, it ends up being, it's almost like a meme. Like you have 20 stories that you've been meaning to write, kind of want to write. You end up writing the one you just thought of a minute ago, you know, like the most recent, you're the most excited about. And I know, not to speak for him, but I know your boy Zach is like that too. He's got a ton of ideas, and it's always the one that most recent, he just thought of it. And a lot of times too, the inspiration, it'll come from just watching a movie or something like that, you sometimes I'll be like, oh, I kind of wouldn't mind doing something kind of like this. And I'm like, oh, then all of a sudden you get the idea, you start writing, that kind of thing.
It's important not to be a dog chasing cars, though.
Yep, have yep.
That focus.
Yeah.
But it's tough. Yeah. For me in particular, it's really tough in terms of not wanting to just spill the beans when I'm like 40 to 50 issues of ideas out ahead. So I got stuff that I'm not going to be even putting out there for like 10 years. And mm-hmm. to not talk about it in detail drives me nuts. Because I would just like to sit down and just spill the beans on everything and be like, this is what's going to happen in this whole
issue. Yeah.
Let's just do yeah. that.
The Pete Cimetti fireside chat, spoiler chat, where all you yeah. do is just tell the whole story.
So, yeah, just to, you know, and just to get that out, because it's like you're torturing yourself. And just to get that out of your system would be great. But at the same time, you got to know that, well, it'll be better when it's in the comic.
Yeah.
Right.
Real quick, Aldeon said he just bought the King Cryptid because they're affordable. And he saw them on your website. So that's cool.
Oh, thank Thanks. You. Appreciate that. Thanks. Also, Paul has a question for you, Narwhal. Well, it's more of like a statement, but says, I was going to ask about getting older work. No options for add-ons for the current Indiegogo.
Yeah, so the eBay, it'll be opening, I'm pretty sure, this week. So keep your eye out. I'll let everyone know, and I'll probably nice. Do a stream to let everyone know.
Very good. And did you okay. have another question or comment yep. there, Ronan?
One more question. When doing mashups between genres, is there any do's or don'ts that you guys can suggest?
Good question. Do you want to go first, Pete, while I think of some? I don't know.
Okay, repeat that one more time, because I was reading the chat, too.
When you're mashing up different genres in a story, is there any solid do's or don'ts that you can suggest?
I guess don't lean too heavily into tropes.
Yeah, I was going to say that, too. Like or cliches, it's like the same.
Yeah.
Whatever. It's, but yeah, like you can tell... Sometimes, too, it's your first instinct is the trope that you've seen a million times. There was a movie that just did that, and it made me roll my eyes. It was the review pointed it out, but it's The Critical Drinker. And the movie is, it's a kind of looks cool, the cool sci-fi movie. It's called The Creator. But it has the trope of the little girl who's the key to everything. And he has to, like, save her or whatever. The second he said that, I knew I'm never going to watch it. I don't think ever in my life, because... That one really has been played out too much, and I'm over it.
So. Yeah, like the little kid that's the key to, it's like the chosen one kind of thing. But
yeah,
it's the
yeah,
little kid, and they got to protect the little kids, like Mercury Rising, that kind of a thing, and like a 400 other stories.
Yeah, but, it's just been done too much, yeah.
Yeah, and I would really say that, like that, yeah, I'd really say too to go with any kind of story you're crafting, whether it's you're mixing genres or not, come from a place of sincerity. And really establish the motivations of what it is your characters want, what it is that they're up against, and what is stopping them from achieving what they're wanting. And that's a good way to craft both heroes and villains, protagonists and antagonists, and even side characters as well, because you can do something where you create a very unassuming side character that all of a sudden you're having these little things build up more and more, and then you can actually have a reveal play out where there's something the reader may not have expected. But that goes for any kind of story. Come from a place of sincerity, because if you're just doing it and you're coming from a place where it's derivative or relying too heavily upon what has influenced you to tell that story, you're going to find yourself just kind of copying everything subconsciously instead of coming from a point where it makes sense that this character is doing that. And then sometimes you can purposefully make something that doesn't seem to like it makes sense for this character, and it catches the reader, and hopefully you're doing it purposefully so that this way it could play out within the story. And you know, so that's how you can craft all kinds of different characters, stories, settings, scenarios, and that's going to keep your story fresh too. But otherwise, yeah, relying Definitely. On that. Yeah, it just becomes.
Yeah, that'll keep it fresh for you as you're writing too, because you'll go places you didn't even plan or expect
when Totally.
You're going for that kind of stuff. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Well, thanks, guys. I appreciate the opportunity.
Yeah, no yeah. problem. Thanks for Ronan. Coming on the show.
Good chatting with you. Yeah.
Appreciate it. All right, up next, we got a lot of people here for Narwhal tonight. I think this is the most guests we've ever had waiting for someone. We got Maddock. What's up, Maddock?
Hello. Up? Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Excellent. Mr. Berg, I was wondering if you could speak to your writing routine, if you have one, and how strictly you stick to it. For one as prolific as yourself, you're putting out a lot of work.
Yeah, thanks. I usually draw 5 days a week and write 1 day a week. And the day I'm going to write, I always write in my notebook the night before and think about it as I'm going to bed. So then, I don't know if this is placebo, but it's like your subconscious doing a little bit of writing while you're sleeping. Then I wake up, chug a bunch of coffee, and I got a 4-hour window before the coffee wears off and I get brain fog. But for that 4 hours, I throw on some music. I can usually get some good stuff done. Sometimes if you write, like, I don't know, a writing day that doesn't quite work out, it can feel kind of bad. And you're like, did I lose it? Am I going to be a bad writer for the rest of my life? Oh. But then a good day feels like the best ever. So it's a interesting, writing is interesting. It's a little bit slightly more high stakes than drawing for me. And that might be because I do it slightly less too.
So the peak is once a week, it's that 4-hour window and you try to hit it then. And if you miss it, you missed it for a week.
I can't really do writing in the middle of the day. So I might just do it the next day or if it's, and even lately, I kind of in a little month or two here where I'm almost just drawing, not even writing.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. And actually when I wrote Grand Prix, I did do a 2-week session of just writing. So there's little breaks or whatever. That was fun too. That was like a lot of inspiration and a lot of like, leaps of faith of writing, not necessarily knowing where it's going to go. I had to start over multiple times with that one. I ended up doing 3 or 4 drafts, and like the first draft got to 30 pages, dead end, have to start over, but I know a little bit more. So I got to 60 pages, dead end, start over. And then I think on the third draft, I kind of got all the way to the end. So that's a weird thing that happened.
So kind of building on it, and it depends on the project.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'll sometimes draw maps. That maps and visuals will help me. If it takes place in a house, I'll try and know a map of the house, or if it's like hotel story in the hotel, or even a little bit of like the town, or in Earthbound, there's a school, stuff like that.
That kind of leads into my other question. Outlining or reference materials, is there anything, you know, talk about a dog chasing a car, you know, you can kind of get lost in playing in Notion or Obsidian or tracking different cards for your different ABC plot. Is there anything you use like that, or do you stick to a more conventional writing?
Usually I'm just writing the script, and then when it's done, that's like the blueprint. But with Earthbound, I did try, I heard it from David Lynch, and he uses like a note card thing, and he writes down, like he says, if you get 80 note cards and each one is a scene, that's a movie. And I was doing a little bit more as like a map of like, I wrote all the 3 main ships that take place in the story, because they kind of become a babushka doll. Like one ship docks the other, then halfway through a bigger ship docks that one. And that's a little like, not a spoiler, but you kind of forget that there's a third ship right in the center of the giant ship. So that plays into the story later. And so keeping track of that kind of stuff, I had it all like on sticky notes on a blackboard. And that's the only time I've done that though, but it did help. And it was kind of fun trying that
kind of a cascading plot outline.
Yeah.
Yeah. With stories, especially for me anyway, where I'm telling an ongoing, it might be different for you where yours is more of a concise, you've got a 1-parter or 2-parter, whatever it may be. With an ongoing, I really love looking at it like it's an old sweater. And it has a bunch of different threads that are just hanging out, and I could just keep tugging at some of the threads and maybe unravel the whole damn sweater one day. But I like to have all those loose threads because certain characters get introduced, certain settings pop up, certain scenarios, certain situations, whatever it may be. And then I can build on that later on, or at the very least, maybe make the reader think that those are going to be built up later on. And see what they're open to, especially nowadays where you can have direct interaction with your audience. If all of a sudden, you know, you're casting out all these different lines and some of the readers are really like, I like that character or that, does that mean something is going to happen with, you know, and you'll see more and more people kind of latch onto that. And then you can develop another story down the line based on that.
Yeah, that's cool. That is a cool advantage of what Pete's doing too.
You can kind of respond to the feedback.
Yeah.
Fantastic. I had one other question. Any updates on Narwhal Film Productions? I know you were casting at one point for your short film.
Yeah.
I think a month or so ago.
Yeah, I know. It's gone so slow. I have a meeting this week to meet with, there's a husband and wife I need to cast, and I'm meeting with the husband. And it's like, I'm also kind of faking it till I make it, but I feel really bad about that. So like, I'm struggling with that. Like with comics, I feel pretty confident. And if I'm paying people, I can like be the boss and it feels natural. I really feel like an imposter doing movies. And so
don't keep pushing it. You do not feel that way for a second. You're on to something. And, half the people in that, more than half the people in that industry have faked it. So.
Yeah. I feel like, hopefully I can I get through it.
You're a storyteller, you know, that's all.
Exactly.
I get a little bit under my belt and then I'll feel a little better. The technical stuff is intimidating. I have a camera, but it's fun, so we'll see where it
goes. For what it's worth, I loved what you were doing, even playing around with settings and trying different things. And, I think something done lo-fi and on a low budget is better than nothing done. So I'm excited to see where it goes.
Cool. Thanks. Yeah. We'll see what I can do. Just do a little something on the side, just kind of for fun, but yeah.
Awesome. Thank you both.
All right.
Yeah. Thanks so Maddox. Good Maddox. Chatting Have with you too. Have a great night. Maddox, super positive, awesome dude on Twitter and YouTube.
I try.
You're a good dude. Thank you, man. Have a great night, buddy. Okay, I got a question here from you got like three more people. I see you. Thank you for being patient. Hold on. Aldeon says a quick question for Pete. It says King Cryptid volumes or issues 5 to 9 are still funding. Are we backing them on Indiegogo or somewhere else? Where should we go to back those? You could go to Indiegogo directly to kingcryptid.com, or you can go to the Alterna site and just go to alternacomics.com/kingcryptid. You'll see on the Alterna site too that there's a thing that says crowdfunders. And we have a couple of different things that are listed, today being actually the last day to get an Alternaween All Ages bundle. But the King Cryptid one is also available on the Alterna site. So thank you, man. Up next, we've got 40% Zed. What's up?
Zed.
Hello.
These are all regulars that I see on my channel, too. So thanks, guys, for being here. Me and Pete have a good crossover.
Good
guys.
Well, I don't get to catch everything. So I was glad I caught this one. And you could hear me this time.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Pete, thank you for being kind. I really didn't want our only interaction to be that time I used your live show to learn how to use a computer. That was awful. I still cringe thinking about it. My hope is going forward, I might call in with a good question or anecdote, and one day we'll meet at a convention and we'll pretend that never happened. But anyway, thank you for having me. And my question for you, Narwhal, is it's not a question. I already ruined it. It's a statement. I think that the best nicknames are the ones you come across by accident. I think Narwhal is a pretty good handle, and it's a funny story how you got it, Ethan being an idiot. So I think it's actually pretty good. I think you should go with it. Like, I have a friend who's like 6'3 and like over 300 pounds, and his nickname is Tiny. That's how nicknames work. They're not logical, but they're fun.
Yeah. I'm into it. I might. Another question is, if I keep going with Narwhal in other, if I do like a short film, do I credit myself as Narwhal? Or maybe I will.
It's almost like Narwhal is your actual name and Per Berg is your pen name.
Yeah. Like Batman and Bruce Wayne. I don't know.
Yeah.
Narwhal is my real face. All right. Well, I want to say hello. Thank you for having me. I'm going to bow out before I do something foolish.
All right.
Have a good night.
Well, thanks, Zed.
Have a great night.
This is fun. This is like literal radio. So it's like kind of fun.
I like it when we have this. It's nice. It's fun. Up next, we've got, hey, Paul. What's up, Paul? How you doing?
Paul, what's up?
Oh, hey, what's going on? You hear me all right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Awesome. There's been a lot of talk. It's interesting. Since both you guys are writers, there hasn't been a lot of discussion about what comics have influenced you. So I guess the question is, as far as movies, music, anything that just stirred your brain and kind of opened things up for you.
What's I think up? We did that on the last show, but we could do that again.
Yeah.
Well, it's okay.
what is like one movie or book you would say for a writer for them to just kind of open their horizons, not teach them how to write, but just something that was like, you read it and you were like, this blew my mind and gave me so
many ideas. It kind of could depend on how old they are too. Cause I don't know, like when I was young, so many books were mind blowing, but like I read a bunch of Philip K. Dick sci-fi when I was younger. And another thing that was mind blowing even kind of recently was the Frank Miller Daredevil. Cause I discovered it kind of late and I didn't know that he was doing such good stuff, you know, even before Batman. And that was so good. It was that, so that was a comic that was like kind of inspirational. Than that, and then for the movie, maybe just Dawn of the Dead. I say that's where I got that strategy, is the story idea. So I've stuck with that for a while now.
Yeah, for me, I guess I'd have to say for comics, Claremont X-Men, Len Wein Swamp Thing. For TV, if I'm talking about animated shows, I guess that I keep on going back to, it's Batman the Animated Series, Thundercats, Real Ghostbusters, Transformers. Movies, man, that one is a little tougher. So I'm just gonna have to say, yeah, just, you know, anything that seems like I would like it, I probably do. Mm-hmm. Anything you see in the intro, you got Rocky, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, Ghostbusters, and then there's other things as well. I mean, I enjoy all kinds of films, but book wise, Scary Stories to Tell in the Dark hit me when I was a kid pretty hard in more ways than one. And then later on, Cannery Row by Steinbeck. That really, yeah, that was like, to me, that's like the Bible of creating character motivation and setting up all kinds of different development plot points for characters.
Cool. I want to read that now. I think I haven't read that one. I've read a few of those like more like literary ones, but not that one.
There you go. Well, before I check out, I'd say as a suggestion, Isaac Bobble's Red Cavalry. He met Maxim Gorky, and Gorky told him, look, you need experience to be a writer. So this guy went and rode out with the Cossacks during the Red Revolution and wrote all these, just pretty much what he encountered in his experiences as short stories, but compiled it into this novella. And it's like seamless the way he does it. The connective tissue, it seems like it's written like a novel, but it's almost like every short story is its own little thing, like Legos. You can just pull out of there and it works on its own. So I would definitely say Isaac Bobble's Red Cavalry for sure.
How do you spell the last name?
B-A-B-E-L.
Oh, okay.
Cool. I'm writing it down.
Yeah. Yeah. We read that one for, I think, Russian literature or whatever like that back in school. Awesome. Great stuff. So
nice. Yeah.
Good conversation, guys. Glad you had me.
Yeah. Thank you very much, man. Appreciate it. I despise Are You Afraid of the Dark? Just want to put that out there. Let's see. Oh, well, both. Okay, that's it. I think that's everybody.
Goosebumps.
Hold on. Alex, are you there?
What's up? I'm heavily influenced by Goosebumps.
I was listening in the background. I forgot I was here. So.
Okay, yeah.
Oh, nice. That's hilarious. I was going to say, you know, the only book. I don't know if this is true. I think this is true. The only book I've ever read twice, because I never read a book twice. I always kind of remember it, so I just don't. But the only book I've ever read twice is the novelization of Donkey Kong Country. It's like 120-page giant font for kids, but it's sort of a novel, like this thick. And I forget the plot, but I've read it two or three times. I don't know why I did, but Donkey Kong Country, novelization.
Hmm. Interesting. Alex, we got a mini bonus round for you. Did you have any question or comment that you wanted to get to?
Sort of. Actually. So, and I told this to Narwhal already, but when I read Cerberus, I felt it was interesting watching the parallel tracks of the animals and the humans both trying to solve the murder. Are you going to develop that angle further in the sequel?
It has a really cool payoff that you'll...
Okay. So like the animals and or the humans will gain information from one another?
Yeah, and there's an awesome kind of emotional, like symbolic thing too that's going to be cool, I think. So awesome. Yeah, it'll be cool.
Yeah, I'm really looking forward to that as well. I remember the scene where the detective stops and he looks like into the forest where the tree was, like directly across from the house. I don't want to spoil anything, but I just remember like thinking to myself, like, does he know somewhere deep in his, in the subconscious, does he like have like a brief realization, like something's going on here?
Yeah. 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 And that is part of the fun of that, and writing that was kind of getting a little bit of the two narratives going at the same time, playing off each other a little bit, for sure.
Fantastic. Well, I really look forward to it. Pete, you are a great creator, and Narwhal as well. And I support both your books. And if you did a collaboration, I would absolutely support that as well.
Yeah. Thanks, man.
Yeah, thank absolutely. So everybody have a good night.
You too, man.
See you, Alex.
Later.
All right. Let's see here. We got... Shrek says, I read Cannery Row, one of the few required reading books in high school that I understood and enjoyed. For me, all we had required in high school was Of Mice and Men and then The Black Pearl. And I didn't care for The Black Pearl. And Of Mice and Men was okay. But later on, my wife, who really, really loves Steinbeck, she was like, you got to read this. I was like, all right, I'll check it out. And it was great. Absolutely great. Nice. Clive Barker, Thief of Always, is great too. And it's not necessarily like, it's got some horror type Clive Barkery elements to it, but it's more of like a supernatural all ages story.
Cool.
Yeah, that one was great.
A real quick random movie one is, have you guys seen Under the Silver Lake? Or have you heard of that one, Pete?
I've heard of it. I haven't seen it.
I like that one a lot. It's the guy, the previous movie he did right before that was a horror movie and it was awesome. It was called It Follows. And then he did Under the Silver Lake, and it has like 1/10 of it kind of randomly is horror because it's a kind of weird movie, but the horror is so good. I'm like, oh, he just put an awesome little horror thing in the middle of the movie, almost like a short story. But that movie is like really hard to categorize, really weird. And that one would have taken a leap of faith to make it, to be like, will this even work? And I think it kind of didn't make that much money. And I want that filmmaker to make another movie. I'm kind of waiting for it. And it also critiques Hollywood.
Check it out.
So I'm like, did they kick him out? But that's a pretty fun one. It's kind of like a novel almost. It's kind of weird.
Stuff. That's funny because I didn't really care for It Follows. So maybe, yeah. Maybe that's why I avoided Under the
Sea. Oh, way. Yeah. Well, it's different. But yeah, so you can think about it, because if you don't like It Follows, but it is different. So that guy is an interesting filmmaker.
Interesting. We're almost at 2 hours, so I guess that's about it. We don't have anybody else in the green room tonight. Other than that, if you guys do have a question in the chat and you want us to get to it before we wrap up in a couple of minutes, please do so. Get those questions out there and we'll try to answer them as best as we can. Iodine says, I love stories but hate reading, mainly because it makes me tired. Hey, yeah. I hear you. You know, it's tough sometime. I do have one question for you. So we've talked a lot tonight about not just this particular story, the hotel story, which is on Indiegogo. Check it out. Link is in the description of the show. But about crafting characters and about working with other creators and about setting up a variety of stories, whether they're self-contained graphic novel style or ongoing series and their episodic serialized storytelling. Is there something in comics specifically that you want to get to in terms of telling a story that you haven't gotten to yet? Is there something on your wish list, your bucket list, as it were?
Yeah, I do think about, there's a few projects that just down the line. One is I want to get all of Earthbound done. Eventually it will be kind of long, but it'll be a little different. It's not exactly like a continuing series, but it'll be like 9 trades by the time it's all done. So, and that will take me like 10 years or whatever I might be done with it. I have some of it written that is not even seeing the light of day yet, but it is written. So I really want to get to that. Then I have one script that I want Monica to draw that I kind of collaborated with Mike Murphy on, who's a great CG writer. And I'm really excited about that one. It's a lot of fun, but it's like, it's, I'm trying to think what it, it's like a Star Trek TV show, and then behind the scenes with the actors, and then one actor like 10 years later who she got kicked off the show. And there's that, you follow the episode where her character dies, and the behind the scenes is you find out one of the producers didn't like the actress, so he worked with a writer to write her off the show. And then 10 years later, she's kind of finding out that that might have been her death on the show, might have been an occult ritual that is now finishing being played out in the in real time in her real life, and she's going to die in real life. But she's like might be going crazy, so it's a little bit of a paranoid thing. So it's got three plots weaving, and it's almost, I don't know if it could be, yeah, like it works really nice as a comic because you can have it like kind of like play off each other, the plots all, but without being redundant. That was like so hard to do, to get it, to get where they rhyme and play off each other, but aren't redundant. And then,
yeah,
but
I think
we did that. So that, and that's going to be a 100-page comic that wraps up completely in 100 pages. And I'm like, that will be the one, if it ever comes out and Monica draws it, I'm like, that would be like, I would really want to submit it to like try to compete with the mainstream of like shaming the mainstream. Like, you guys do something this good, I dare you try and do that. But
all right. Interesting, man. We got one more person here. Are you comfortable with taking on one more person?
Yeah, I love it. I like being here. Thanks for having me. It's fun going a little over too. So it's hanging out.
No problem. Okay. Mysterious Mystery Man, what's up? You're on Comic Book Radio with Narwhal.
Greetings, Pete. Narwhal.
Yo, hello. What's up, man?
Good to see you. All right, Narwhal, I have a question for you. And I hope this doesn't make you uncomfortable. But it's a very important question, and it must be answered.
Okay,
don't
what
make
is
me
it?
Kick you out, Mysterious Mystery Man.
Pete, I haven't done anything yet. Come on.
All right, all right.
All right. So, look, I know I'm not the only one that's been thinking this. I'm pretty sure Pete's been thinking this. Irene, yes or no?
Oh, that's funny. I don't know.
About what? Yes or no to what?
Just yes or no.
Well.
What does that
mean? I don't know. Yeah, I can't. I'm afraid I can't answer. Yeah, sorry. But I sort of know what you're saying. All positive things, I would say. So in that sense, a yes.
I don't even know.
I think, they're shipping me and Irene potentially. I'm not sure, but.
All right, he did that crap when Malin was on, too. Mysterious Mystery Man, if you ever come back on the show, I'm kicking you automatically. And the reason, because, number one, grow up. Number two, I'm married. Number three, what the hell are you trying to stir up? All right, because you come on here, you're not using your name, you're not on camera, and then you ask questions like that. And then you, if you want to play like a 14-year-old, and you can watch and sit down with the rest of the kids at the kids' table. That's the third time you've done that, man. Not cool.
Fair enough.
Narwhal, it was great having you on tonight. Appreciate it.
Yeah, thank you. Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. Everybody, go check out Hotel Story. This is on Indiegogo. I'm giving this a quick refresh here, see if we got any backers during the course of the show.
We will, though. People know it's out there. So
yeah, you're at 210. You got 16 days left, but you said this is going to be up for 4 months, correct?
Yeah, it's going to get extended and then go in demand for a little bit. So no super hurry. Put away $1 a day and back it. You know, I want to get as many as possible. Get some readers in here checking this one out. I'm really excited about this one. Really, really proud of it. Really happy with it. So.
Very nice. 12,377 raised. Go check out Hotel Story. The link is in the description of the show. And again, go subscribe to Narwhal's channel. The link is also in the description of the show. Other than that, where can they find you?
My channel, Narwhal Books, and Twitter, I think is just, it's Narwhal, whatever you search, find me. And keep an eye out for the eBay store to launch in this week. So yeah.
Awesome. Very nice. Everybody, thank you guys for being here. Everyone that came on, except for Mysterious Mystery Man, thank you guys for your questions and for coming on the show. Appreciate it. And I'm dead serious. I'm not cool with that kind of stuff. This is not the place for it. This is not the show for it. And again, that's why I told them. I was like, what are you doing? Don't make me kick you. We had this conversation before. Not cool. Everybody else, though, thank you so much. Nothing but love. Thank you guys in the chat. Thank you, Narwhal. Everybody, go check out what Narwhal's doing. He's got a hotel story on Indiegogo. And other than that, thank you guys. Have a wonderful evening. A great night. A great night. And an even better tomorrow. See you guys soon.